Hello, hello, and welcome to Quackalope, where today we are going to be talking about Weirdwood Manor. It's going to be coming out on Kickstarter here very shortly if it's not out already, and I highly recommend you check it out. But there is a gigantic caveat that I have to throw out there before I tell you any more about it. It has nothing to do with them paying us. In fact, this is a freebie because I saw this game, I thought it looked amazing, and I said, please send this to me because I want to cover it, I want to play it, I think it has some really cool ideas, and it looks like it's something that would make me smile. I was correct in all of those things. Super glad to have played it, super glad to have an opportunity here. I even took it to a con and we played it multiple different player accounts, super excited about it. The problem is, I played it so much that I had taken all of the little pieces out and put them to the side. And so yours truly, apparently, managed to leave all the little pieces back at my house. So you're gonna have to take my word for it on a little bit of this stuff because I kinda left some of the pieces at home. And I'm really sorry. But I hope that you guys can forgive me on this because I still wanna talk about the game and I didn't want to wait until later or miss out on an opportunity to tell you guys about it because this game was so much fun. Anyway, Weirdwood Manor. The whole premise of the game is that you are these, these teenage kids that have special powers, and you're going into this amazing manor, and you are trying to save Lady Weirdwood from the center area here in the throne room. Now, there are various Fae monsters that are trying to take advantage of you and to take out Lady Weirdwood. The one that I played the most was this ogre right here. He's a terrible, horrible chaos ogre. But there's also the Theris and the Minwraith as well. They all play completely differently. They all have their own set of asymmetric powers. They have a completely different deck and way of working, so it's really unique. You're going to have three different monsters to play in this particular scenario. And in addition to that, you've got six different characters that you can play at currently, and again, all of them being asymmetric, which is amazing because it's really interesting and each one of them does something just a little bit different and adds just a little bit more entertainment to the game, which was again another reason why I really enjoyed it. But let me tell you the other reason why I really enjoyed this. This has probably the most unique time of day track and day track I've ever seen. It's kind of a rondel, but kind of not. Let me show you. The idea is that you're going to be moving your player throughout this manor and trying to get to the center to save Lady Weirdwood from these horrible scarabs that you can't actually see that should be on the board, but because again, don't forget, I forgot some of the pieces at home. There are these amazing 3D scarabs that'll be put throughout this area here. You can kind of see there's some that would be laid out here, but there'll also be some in the center area here, as well as around the board, and they will kind of move through things and do other interesting things that we'll get to in a moment. But the whole premise is, as you're playing cards and doing things on your track, the time is going to be changing. And the way that the time change is that you just move this little dial. So let's say it's in the morning here, and you're gonna play a morning action, you have to move the dial at least one place. Now, if you'll notice, that has now unlocked this corridor so we can get through, but it had locked this one out, and now this one is open, and this is locked, and this is open. Every single action you take, every card you play, changes what is available to you throughout this piece. Now, the way that card action works is that you're going to have a hand of cards, it's generally three, and then you're going to have an opportunity to play them along top of your board here. Now, there's a morning action, a daytime action, an evening action, and a nighttime action. So you'll take a card from your hand. Let's say in this particular circumstance, I want to do a charge. And I'm still in the morning phase, so I'm gonna put it up here, showing that it's the morning phase. And then I have to move the morning tracker, or have to move the daytime tracker forward at least one space. And forward here means counterclockwise. So I have to move it this far. Now I could, if I wished, go ahead and go all the way around. And go to the next morning phase, and if I were to do so, then I would have to push this daytime tracker one space ahead. So I'm now on day two. Now you might be asking yourself, Wes, it doesn't matter, there's a total of 12 days. What care does it happen if I happen to move it forward an entire day? Yay, let me tell you, the farther along you get, the more powerful your foe becomes, especially in the case of the chaos monster. The first 4 days seems to be relatively calm, no big deal. I mean, he still hurts a lot when he tries to kill you, but it's not quite so bad. Then the next day when he gets a little more angry, he's going to get more dice that'll do more damage to you, and he'll be able to block the same amount, but he has three extra dice. And then if he manages to make it all the way to enraged and you haven't taken him out yet, Well, then you're going to have a really bad day, because let me tell you, fighting against five of the crazy red aggravation dice there, it's not a good day for you. You're going to have a really bad time. He's going to hurt a whole heck of a lot there. So you want to be very conservative with your actions. You want to be very careful about the time that you're using. And mixed in all of this, you still have to move around this entire area and be able to take the actions in these associated rooms, so you have to make sure that the place that you're going to want to go to is available to you in the time of day action that you have. I know that might sound a little crazy, but here's the idea. Each of these rooms has different actions that are available to you. Now, you could either pick up resources, you could discard cards, you could gain additional health, you could destroy a scarab in a different room. You could actually portal to a different location. You could also create dice. There's a dice creation location here somewhere. Here we go. There's the forge, a couple of different forges where you could actually create additional dice for yourself if you pay the cost for them. And you could choose between the different dice that are available to you. You can have a balanced dice, which has the attack, it has defend, and it also has a special ability here, which is different for each individual character. There's the aggressive dice, which will be all of these amazing swords, so to speak. So it'll be attack-based dice, but there are, of course, some blank sides. And then there's the defense dice, which will allow you to get up to two different shields, but again, you could potentially have nothing. And there are no attacks on this dice, so it really is just a defend dice, whereas that's an attack dice and a balance dice. So you can forge all these different things, and that's great. You can actually use those as health. If the monster were to attack you, you could sacrifice a die instead of having to have a particular amount of health. Because as you're going through the board, you'll be granting yourself additional health along this health track here. And there's no way for you technically to die in this game. You could reduce your health all the way down to one, and then you just start getting rid of some resources, which will be these purple things here, that again, I left at home. But they're really nice wooden purple things with stars on them. They're amazing. The other things that you could do, like I said, you can get rid of dice, and that will also help you, but they're very expensive to forge, so you probably don't want to do that as much as possible. So you might want some of those defense dice for that reason. But you also want to be able to kill things, so the red dice are vitally important, but they get more and more expensive as the game goes on. So keep all of this in mind. Now, the other interesting thing about the card-based actions is as you're placing things across here at the top, you may find that you can make connections. So in this particular scenario, I've made a connection of a sword there. So if I were to take an attack action, I would not only have the swords that I find along my bottom XP track here, but I could also add an additional sword plus the sword that I might roll. So therefore, if in this particular scenario, let's say I did this, I would have three swords here plus one sword there, so that would give me a total of four swords that I could use towards attacking the bad monster or the scarabs or what have you. And then I would be able to defend against one attack as well. That is fantastic. I will tell you that this mechanism up here at top is exciting. There's also another interesting point here, which I forgot to grab. But it's these cards. These are Warden Tactic cards. And these will be very special cards that you'll be able to use throughout the game. And they replace the top portion here on this area. So now, instead of this being a sword, it's now a wild for both sides. So even if, let's say, I was going to do this action next, I still have my sword action here, and now I have an additional book for any action that requires a book. I don't have to pay that because now I have a special book here. And the great thing about this is until you clear this off, all of these things stay. So I will always have this extra sword and I will always have this book for any transaction that I'm looking for until I have to clear it off. And when you clear things off, bad things happen, because you would imagine there could be bad things out there. So if you're having to clear off all the cards, you're going to do a scarab phase. And the scarab phase puts more scarabs on the board. So the scarabs will start moving back from these areas. They'll go back into these areas here. These ones here in the middle sections will go back into these. And then you'll add more scarabs down in the center. And any time that two scarabs go to the same room during a scarab phase, it will become a blighted room. And you'll no longer have access to that action. and you'll have to pay the cost to flip the room back over to be able to then potentially use that action in the room again. Now, I will tell you that the Scarab phase is very dangerous, because I found quite often that what ends up happening in the game is that, well, I finish all of my cards and I have to do the clearance phase, get everything open again for me. And wouldn't you know it, the next person that I'm playing with has to basically do it again. So that Scarab phase happens almost like in a row, several times in a row. It feels really rough and very punishing, but it's also exciting because it's more things for you to kill, and you need scarabs as some of the different resources. So you could take it and just get extra experience, or you could use those scarabs as resources and just gain one experience for killing it, and then save that scarab carapace to be able to use for various and sundry other things along the board. Now, one of the things that I will say about this game is there's also another section here, which will be companions. And these companions are really unique in that they give you special abilities as well. Like some of them will require you to flip over the companion to be able to utilize the action. And other ones will just give you this special thing. So like this one, just it's always giving you two extra shields. So no matter what happens, you're always gonna have two extra shields. The other thing about these companions that's very unique is that you could technically have as many as you want. So the cost to have a companion is whatever the cost of the companion is. And then if you already have a companion, it'll be two additional items. And so then if you were to put down another companion here, you would have the cost of whatever this companion is, plus two additional items, gets you this companion here. And then if you do this again, and so on, you can have a whole bunch of companions going across the side. Not only do they give you special abilities, the interesting thing is they also allow you to have a wild location space to put a card down. So not only does it extend and push out that scarab phase longer and longer throughout time, which is fabulous, but it also gives you another opportunity to have a wild space, which is vitally important, because sometimes you don't want to put this knight action here because it's already gone by. Because while you're taking your turns and you're thinking to yourself, oh, West, it's not that hard to do this. It's clear. I just, a morning phase, a day phase, an evening phase, a night phase. You're 100% correct. If that was the only thing happening in this game, you could easily do that and not have to worry about a thing. But wouldn't you know it, those doggone ogres and chaos, they're going to do some fun things for you as well. They have their own little deck of cards here, and as you can see across the bottom, there's some little time clocks down there. So that means on their turn, they're going to advance the time as well. So now when they're advancing the time, in this particular circumstance, they're advancing it three spaces. So that completely throws everything out, and now we're in the day phase. Well, doggone it, that might still be okay, but if there's two people playing with us, well, maybe I need to play a day phase, or in this particular circumstance, I don't have a day phase available. So I have to put it over here on one of my wild locations, or I have to use an evening phase. And an evening phase is like, it's half the day away. Whew, or a night phase, I mean. That's half the day away. That could be really challenging and very tough. So the management of this particular thing in your head is very challenging. Add into the fact that you're constantly trying to figure out, well, which room can I go to? Because as soon as you get ready to play your card, you have to advance this at least one space. And now, well, maybe the room you were trying to get into is no longer available because you advanced it. And now that room you need isn't, you can't get into it. It was a beautiful puzzle that was really exciting and fun to try and figure out. I think that was one of the things that made this game stick out to me. And because it was so unique, was so interesting, and it was so different, and that constantly shifting idea of how you get into one place and how, and sometimes you get stuck in a location, because I will tell you, I've been in these back rooms and then all of a sudden the day shifts. Well, if my character's over here in this spot, congratulations, that I'm stuck. I can't move. I can't get out of this spot unless I've got a card that can port me out of that particular room, or someone else takes an action to port me into a different room. So keeping all of that stuff in your mind as you're playing it, and sometimes that causes you to advance the time an entire day so that you can push the day forward to get yourself out of a room. All of that stuff in mind made this game very interesting and very thought-provoking and very constantly changing, shifting, and challenging. I really, really enjoyed that puzzle. Add in killing the scarab bugs, trying to figure out how to defeat this ogre. This particular ogre is really unique in that he's got three different body parts. So as you're attacking him, you can choose to, well, do I hit his head, do I hit his arm, or do I hit his leg, or his hand, excuse me. So you can attack those specific body parts, and eventually you can kill that particular body part, disable it, whatever you want to say, which takes a dice away from him, which is great, especially towards the end. You want to get all these things as far away from him as you possibly can. But in these particular circumstances, you'll have these little cubes here like this, and you could take one cube off and have no worries. If you take that second cube off, you have to do whatever that action says. And in this particular circumstance, that action says you have to add a scarab to the room. So you'll roll the dice, or to the manor. So you'll roll the dice. This says outside line goes to number two, which is right there. So we'd have to add a scarab to that room. This mechanic was also really entertaining, because as I was trying to kill him, more scarabs were coming up and showing up everywhere, and if you don't control the scarabs, then your mansion starts falling apart. And then you've got to try and figure out how to deal with that, because that gets very frustrating. It was a really, really interesting game, looking at all the different pieces, trying to keep track of all the different things that were going on. And it might sound a little overwhelming, and I don't mean for it to be, because it wasn't. It was fun. It was entertaining. It was interesting. And this game, like 90 minutes. I played two-handed once, was probably the better part of just a little over an hour. I took this to a con, taught it to several different people, and each of those games, 90 minutes, I think we had one that was maybe like 110 minutes, but that was also including a teach. So, great. I think it's a fabulous playtime. And with all these different powers and abilities that are available to you throughout the game, each of these different characters feels different. They have different things that they get to do. You know, some of them are focused on healing. Some of them are focused on movement. Some of them are focused on thievery and stealing things. There's others that are actually really good at putting down different cards over top of the same cards. You just keep pushing that scarab phase out farther and farther for yourself. If you play these characters correctly, there's a lot of different and unique things that you can do with them. And what I also really liked is on the back here, it tells you about what those little abilities are, and then it gives you a gamer suggestion. Hey, this is how you use this. This is really good at the beginning of the game. This is really good at the end of the game. This is a situational thing, but it's really strong when that situation happens. So make sure you keep it in mind when you're looking through the game. Really, really well done, really well thought out. Everything is absolutely gorgeous. And again, please understand my caveat when I say this. All of these little pieces were beautiful wooden pieces. The scarab was a 3D scarab. It's just beautiful. It's incredibly well done, absolutely beautiful pieces. These boards are amazing. This board here in the center is incredible. Tear down and put together, I can get it done in about 10 minutes. So not hard at all. I think overall this game is definitely one that is instantly going to be added to my collection. I remember when I first played it here at the Quack House, I thought to myself, I said, you know, this game's pretty unique. I really like this. I think Shira's gonna love it. And then the more I started to play it, the more I realized, yeah, actually I really like this game. This game is really fun. It's 100% being added to my collection. So I highly recommend you take a look at this game. I hope you have an opportunity to check it out. Apparently, there is an IP as well. There's an Apple thing on the Apple Play Store for a Weirdwood Manor, and there's also some books through Amazon. More teenager-associated, but still really unique, very interesting. And this game is incredible, so it's really, really cool to see how they're drawing in characters from a different series, trying to put them in here, but I do believe, I could be wrong in this, but I do believe that the IP is owned by the publisher, so it's something that they can continue to keep adding to without fear of losing the IP in the future. So anyway, having said all of that, hopefully you'll take an opportunity to look at this game. As we all know, I love acrylic minis, so that makes me very happy. Dual layer player boards, beautiful pieces, really unique mechanisms throughout the game that really add something incredible and something different that I haven't seen done before, at least not in this way. Please check it out. There will be a link in the description below. And thank you very much for watching. As always, remember, get out and do the important thing, right? Save the mistress. That's what we're doing. We're saving the mistress right here. She's very important. We can't let the Chaos Ogre get her, okay? I really like Wally Cooper. He's a thief. He steals dice from the bad guy and then rolls them. It's super cool. Anyway, thanks, guys. Appreciate you being here. Bye.